Welcome to BNews Weekly. I'm Phil Gallagher, along with BNews Director Rich Hosford, BNews reporters Tad Stefanak, Robert Parris, and Chris Flaherty. Peter Brown with the weather, Matt DiMarzio with sports, and Ian Cassiola with the community bulletin board. And I hope that you've recovered from the euphoria of the Patriots Super Bowl win. I know I barely have after having watched it an additional four times. The Burlington Board of Selectmen voted 5-0 on Monday night to give Department of Public Works Director John Sanchez the go-ahead to enter into contract discussion with a company looking to reduce the amount of trash sent to the incinerator. The company is Waste Zero, a certified B Corporation, and the proposal before the town is curbside textile collection and recycling. Sanchez said that typically about 95% of unwanted textiles go into the trash rather than being donated. Those would include old clothes, hats, gloves, shoes, and things of that sort. He said the idea is to offer another outlet to the residents so that they can dispose of it in an environmentally friendly way. The best way, of course, would be to donate it. However, if you're not, Waste Zero would give bags to the residents who request them, who could then fill them with unwanted cloth materials and leave the bags next to their trash on pickup days. Any bags left would then be replaced with another for future use. Sanchez said the clothes and other textile materials would be brought to a sorting facility. Those in good condition would be sold to thrift shops, while those of second-tier quality would be shipped overseas for markets in developing countries. The rest would be made into carpet, insulation, or something of that sort. The DPW director said the program would not cost the town any money, and it may actually help it save on trash disposal costs by lowering the amount of tonnage that's delivered to the incinerator. The town pays $70 per ton of trash that is delivered there. So obviously any additional ton that's saved would reduce the overall cost of the town's trash budget. A familiar face at the Burlington Fire Department has a new position. At Monday night's Board of Selectmen meeting, Town Administrator John Petrin approved the promotion of Lieutenant Mark Cedrone to Captain. Cedrone was promoted to fill a place left vacant after Captain Scott Carpenter, a 32-year veteran of the department, retired. Cedrone's promotion was recommended by Fire Chief Yetman and Assistant Chief Patterson. The chief said that Cedrone joined the Burlington Department in 2001 and was promoted to lieutenant in 2008. When the captain positions opened, five current lieutenants were interviewed and tested, and Cedrone had the top performance. Petrin said he was happy to make the promotion. As part of the 50th anniversary to celebrate the Burlington Recreation Department, they held a winter carnival this past weekend. BNews reporter Robert Parris was there with a BCAT crew, and he has this look at the action.
Hey everybody, I'm Robert Parris here for the winter carnival. I'm ready if you are. Let's go! It was a winter wonderland up on the hill at Simons Park. On Saturday, February 11th, a winter carnival was held by the Burlington Recreation Department as they are continuing to celebrate their 50th anniversary with special events new and old throughout the year. Despite the freezing temperatures, the activities were endless. Turkey toss, a chili cook-off, a bonfire with s'mores, hot chocolate, and plenty of sledding. The Burlington version of UConn Cornelius was there, also known as Brendan Egan.
I'm here with Brendan Egan, Director of Parks and Recreation. Brendan, how you doing today?
Great. How are you? Nice and warm?
Yeah, totally warm. It's a balmy spring day.
It is. Well, you know what? It's a winter carnival. We didn't have snow. Made the call to Mother Nature. She dropped some snow on us. That's what kind of pull the Parks and Recreation Department has with Mother Nature.
She delivered, I gotta say. She's been delivering since Thursday.
She has, and it looks like more this weekend to come, so that's good.
Maybe this winter carnival will be a multi-day carnival.
Well, I think we're sticking with the one day, but it will be a winter wonderland for many days to come.
That's perfect. Brendan, can you give me a little behind the scenes on what it took to make the winter carnival happen?
Sure. Program staff, this is one of our 50th anniversary events. The program staff has been working since last summer on events for this year. You know, this is one of our new ones that we may bring back year after year. So we're doing a winter carnival.
Can you guess what sport this is? Give up? It's curling. Julie Atwood got a chance to speak with Brian and Jesse from the rec department on how they created their own version of curling for the winter carnival.
Hi, this is Jolie, and I'm here with...
I'm Brian.
I'm Jesse. And we're at the curling station on the winter carnival at Simon's Park. So, how's
curling? Well, we didn't know. So, we took the pole and kind of just pushed the thing. It's like, it's kind of amateur curling here. We're not the Olympics with the stones that you throw. So we're playing along, we're making it up.
Chili today, hot tamale, and it was sure hot in the preschool where the chili cook-off was held. Surprisingly, there were only two contestants. So which chili would rise up to the top? Well, it was a 50-50 chance for each contestant, as Matty Shipka and Chris Flaherty spoke with the chili contenders and their secret recipes.
I'm here with our first contestants of the chili cook-off, and how are you guys doing today?
Not too bad. How you doing?
Pretty good. Can you tell us your names?
I'm George Panago.
I'm Benjamin Panago.
George and Ben, nice to meet you guys. So how long have you been cooking chili?
This recipe, about 20 years.
20 years, wow. Has it been altered, changed over the years, or have you stuck with the original ingredients?
No, I've modified it through the years.
Oh, wow. I won't divulge any secret family recipes, but any like unique ingredients in there?
I think probably the carrots are the big surprise.
I did notice the carrots, and they were delicious.
Throw them in there to break up the spiciness with a little sweet.
So I'm Maddie, here with...
Hi, I'm Kirsten.
And we're at the chili cook-off. So, is this an old family recipe?
Yeah, this is my mom's recipe, and I believe she got it from her mom.
So how long have you been cooking it?
I haven't. My mom gets all the credit. She cooked it. She made it for our big Super Bowl party where she invites all of her and my dad's friends. And I brought it, and I'm pretending to get all the credit, but it's really my mom.
So do you know of any special ingredients? We don't want to use any secret.
It's all about the cup of love. That's all she tells me. There's just a cup of love in there.
Well, the Winter Carnival was a great success. And Frosty really came today, and it's really freezing. But anyways, for BNews Weekly, I'm Robert Paris. I'll catch you next time.
A man with a long history of service in the Burlington community passed away this past weekend. Charles Joseph Cavalier, Charlie, a World War II veteran and Burlington First Veterans Agent, passed away in his Billerica home on Saturday, February 11th at the age of 88. Cavalier was also an assessor for the town, coached basketball for many years for the rec department, was very involved with St. Margaret's Church, and was a founding member of the Burlington Knights of Columbus. At the age of 18, he enlisted in the U.S. Coast Guard. He served during the final year of World War II. He held the rank of fireman first class and was discharged in April of 1947. You can read his full obituary at www.bcattv.org/bnews. The Burlington High Select Singers are working hard to prepare for a special performance at a world-famous venue in New York City. BNews Director Rich Hosford went to speak with the members of the group to find out more. He files this report.
In the chorus room at Burlington High School, the BHS Select Singers are hard at work mastering six songs for a performance of a lifetime. This April, the group will join with other high school student singers for a night of performance at none other than the historic Carnegie Hall in New York City.
Of course, the opportunity to sing at Carnegie Hall, you just can't beat that. And what we'll be doing is we'll be joining probably about 150 other high school choral students who will meet at Carnegie Hall and sing under the direction of a well-known conductor. His name is Dr. Jerry Blackstone, and he's a fabulous person to work with. I've gotten the chance to work with him before, and the kids are just going to have a great time.
As one would expect for a performance at Carnegie Hall, the music selections are challenging. Ms. Weller said this has meant the students have had to practice long and hard and also learn new skills and techniques. The result, she said, is overall stronger performers.
Well, our conductor, Dr. Blackstone, who will conduct us at Carnegie, he's chosen six musical selections that are very challenging. And have really helped us grow as musicians. There's classical pieces, there's more contemporary works, there's some works that have really intricate harmonies that are hard to tune. So we're able to do a lot of the sight reading and ear training and musicianship work in our class as select singers. We're able to apply that right away to the Carnegie music that we're performing. And that's really meaningful too, because it will not just be a wonderful memory for the students, but it will help us build our musical skills as well.
And of course, the opportunity to play at such a historic and well-known venue will be an experience the students will never forget.
I mean, the great majority of musicians and performers never have the opportunity to sing at Carnegie Hall. So to say that even before you're 18, you have a chance to sing on the Carnegie Hall stage is really exceptional. It's by far, one of our premier performance venues in our country, and certainly in New York City. And so it'll be a very historic event for these kids, hopefully a memory they'll have forever.
I also spoke to a couple of the singers who told me how they got their start in singing and why they joined the Select Singers.
So I've been interested in the chorus ever since I can remember. I've been singing since I could speak, I guess. And all through my life, I knew that I did want to continue music. So I decided to audition for Select Singers back when I was in eighth grade for the high school program, thinking that it was a long shot because there were all these talented high schoolers in it. And I got in, and it's changed my life.
So as a sixth grader, I was in the elementary schools, and I really liked to sing. So I got into the Select chorus up at the middle school, and I really liked it. So, of course, I went up to the high school to pursue it, and I was so lucky enough to get into Select Singers my freshman year, and I'm very happy I made that decision.
The students said being part of the group has had a big impact on their lives at BHS.
So coming in as a freshman, it was really nerve-wracking for me. I'm pretty sure I could say that for everybody. But coming into the chorus, I felt like everybody was just so positive and helping me get around the school and stuff like that. And I'm always, thankful for everybody who's helped me.
Definitely one of the biggest impacts I can think of is the chorus has definitely become a family. Like, all of my best friends are in a room with me once a day, and it just gives me an opportunity to really perfect my craft, because I do intend to pursue music, specifically choral music, in college. So it's definitely a nice thing to have for a background.
Crystal performed at Carnegie Hall with the group a couple of years ago and said it was a magical experience.
That experience is one of the best experiences of my life. I will never forget what it felt like when we first walked into Carnegie Hall for our first rehearsal in the actual space, and I was surrounded by more than 100 individuals who were all like-minded like me with their goals of choral singing and performing at such a higher level. And it was just incredible to look out into an audience of so many people that were all so supportive, and to know that I made it to Carnegie Hall.
This will be Mikey's first trip to New York, and he's excited about the opportunity.
I am very excited. I've actually never been to New York City before, so I've heard so many wonderful things about Carnegie Hall. So I've seen pictures of it online, and it's such a beautiful hall. So it's really not every day that you go around and tell your friends, I'm performing in Carnegie Hall in April.
At the Chorus Room, I'm B News Director Rich Hosford.
A poised and articulate young people we have here in Burlington. Burlington High School students and teachers from the Spanish Exchange Program are overseas for 2 weeks for an exotic and adventurous trip to Spain. Students and teachers who are in Spain have been sharing their experiences on the high school blog website. This gives Burlington residents an opportunity to follow the trip. The students have been traveling to both cities and more rustic natural locations during the trip. They have visited famous museums, tried new foods, met a lot of new people, engaged in activities such as rowboating and hiking. You can find a link to the blog, which contains both photos from the trip and student writings, on our website at www.bcattv.org/bnews. CoLab, Burlington High School's multi-award winning literary magazine. The periodical features fiction, essays, poetry, and art by Burlington students, with issues selling out almost as fast as they can print them. CoLab meets Fridays after school and attracts a diverse array of the student body. BNews' Tad Stefanak met with CoLab and has this report on Burlington's creative scholars.
Encouraging young writers and artists is essential to giving today's teenagers a chance at scholarships, being published, and gaining recognition that can lead to greater opportunities in the future. Burlington High School is brimming with writing and artistic talent being acknowledged on a national level through their award-winning literary and art magazine, CoLab.
We have been entering contests for the past few years. We're right now in the process of finishing up our reading for this year's edition, but the news we've just received in the past month is that we came in first place in the ASPA National Contest. We were rated the top literary magazine in the U.S. for any school of our size, 1,000 to 1,700 students. We also came in to the final round of the NCTE contest, which is a very prestigious contest, which put us in the top second tier, but this is the third year in a row that we've made it to the final table at the NCTE contest. We just found out about both of those in the past couple weeks.
BHS senior Alyssa Healy is a member of CoLab and headed to art school following graduation.
I like seeing all the work that the students at BHS do, and I also just love the people in the club. We're all really supportive of each other, and it's really nice.
Senior Neil Ford is the senior editor for the magazine, who plans on pursuing an automotive technical career following high school. I asked about his process.
So we start off with a four-number system and then just choose, like, oh, we think this is really good, we think this is not so good, and then we think this is somewhat in between, and then as a group we'll get together and decide to weed out the best, and then there's obviously some that are just like, this isn't going in, and then this is amazing, we're gonna put this in no matter what.
Well, in the art classes, we don't really like cater to CoLab, we just make things and then send them in, and if they happen to like align with the writing, then we put those together, so we kind of match them up in that way.
I'm head editor of fiction, so my final say is I get to choose one piece that I really liked and say, this one's in, and I'm gonna write a little bit about why I thought it was so good. So like last year, there was a satirical piece that everyone else in CoLab was like, this isn't the best. And I was like, wait, this is really cool, guys. If you look at it from this angle, where it's supposed to be a comedy and it's not being serious in any way, shape, or form, it's actually really funny. And then they were like, oh yeah, this is pretty cool. So that's what I do.
The things we have coming up next, we have the art contest. We're going to have judging on that, and that will determine which of the selections for artwork make it into the magazine, which ones don't. We're going to be making our final decisions on what writing pieces probably in the next week or two come in. In addition to that, we have the final thoughts contest, which is a writing contest for seniors of any style of writing, and we'll have an announcement on the winner of that very soon, and then that will push us toward our sales drive and actually publishing and releasing the magazine, which will be around this spring.
Ultimately, CoLab is about the synergy of wordsmiths and visual artists coming together at Burlington High School.
Go find some paper. Hold on one second.
Mr. Lally definitely makes it really fun, and all of the kids, no matter like what class we're in, we all get along, and it's really great.
I'm going to college to be an automotive technician, so it's slightly different than what a lot of the rest of the people are doing in this club, but I still love this club.
So we meet on Fridays after school. Anybody who wishes to come in and help out as an editor is absolutely welcome. It's a very nice group. They're a very welcoming group.
I just think that everyone should try and get involved, whether it's submitting to CoLab or being in the club, because it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, so if people would like to pick up a copy, we still have some left. They're usually we sell out by the time the next one comes out. We're down to our last maybe 10 or so copies, but there are copies at True North in Burlington. You can also, students can buy one from me, from any of our head editors on the magazine, and they're $10, and the proceeds from that go for paying for the next year's magazine. It's a nonprofit. We use the funds from the sales to pay for our contest prizes and for buying the magazine the next year.
From the Burlington High School English Department, I'm BNews reporter Tad Stefanak. Back to you in the studio.
A lot of recognition should go to Mildred Nash, long-term town meeting member, as well as an English teacher at Burlington High who was involved for many years in the production of the CoLab material. Certainly a great credit to Burlington High School that that the magazine has achieved at these levels and the people involved in it. The Burlington Historical Society will be hosting an organization that is working to remember all the men and women of the armed forces with a Massachusetts connection who have passed since the attacks of September 11, 2001. The Operation Home Ties and Faces of Remembrance, Traveling Tribute Wall, is coming to the Society's meeting on Thursday, March 2nd, starting at 7 p.m. Operation Home Ties is a volunteer mission by local portrait artist Gina Johnson and her brother Paul Roth to honor memory of all fallen servicemen and women, starting with those who have ties to Massachusetts and served since 9/11/01. The exhibit features a detailed pencil memorial portrait of each fallen soldier, which has been presented to their families, and a copy placed on the traveling wall. According to the site, the project's inspiration came to Gina in December of 2007 after seeing an online tribute to Massachusetts' falling heroes. Well, one of the mistakes we always make is somewhere around January, early February, we say to ourselves, my, isn't this a mild winter? Well, we got our first real snow of the season this past week. There's more on the way. To find out, we go to BNews weatherman Peter Brown for the latest forecast. We'll also check out the community calendar with Ian Cassiola to see what's happening in Burlington.
Well, hello everyone. This is Peter Brown with a look at your weather for the next 7 days. And if you can believe it, look at this. Up to February 17th, we actually have fewer than 2 weeks left of meteorological winter. So that's definitely a positive sign ahead. And I'm sure you're probably looking for a much warmer weather forecast after the past week that we've had. We actually had more snow the past week than we had had the entire rest of our winter going back to the beginning of December. So that was quite the thing and quite the surprise. As we start off, though, look at here. Starting off on Friday, we're going to see temperatures pretty chilly again. So something that's been pretty much the mainstay for the past 7 to 10 days. Temperatures are only going to be around 30 to start off our Friday. So pretty chilly, little breezy out there. So going to be a little bit of bite to the air when you're going out there on Friday. But the only thing you can notice here, look at this. The days are definitely getting much longer. So it's really great. You're probably getting up and you're going into work and the sun is coming up and you're actually getting home for the most part before the sun goes down. So that's really a nice sign that spring is definitely on the way. As we move ahead, I'm going to show you a little bit about what's going to be going on with our weather for the next 7 days. And this is something I'm sure very refreshing to any of you who maybe might not be so inclined to like the snow as some people may. Now, this is going to be a very quiet pattern actually coming up for us here in the Burlington area for the next 7 days. We're really going to be seeing just partly cloudy skies for most of the next week here. The only chance for rain is we may have a weak system moving towards the north of southern New England. Maybe as we get in towards the tail end of our 7 day period, so looking into next Tuesday through next Thursday, we may see the chance of some spotty showers here and there in the Burlington area. But other than that, just those 2 days. Other than that, we're going to mostly have just a mix of sun and clouds around, and actually some very nice temperatures compared to what we've seen the past 7 days. And as you can see, no big snowstorms coming up from the south, so that's not going to be something we're going to have to worry about here in southern New England. As we go ahead, I'm going to show you a little bit about that past snowstorm that we saw this past Sunday going into Monday. And as you can see up here in the Burlington area, we got a fairly good amount. It was actually one of our larger snow systems that we've had in the past 2 years. That's for sure. As you remember, last winter we saw almost no snow, really no snowstorms at all. But look at this right here in the Burlington area, really from around Bedford up to Wilmington. We got into a little bit of a dry slot with this last snowstorm that we had, and we actually only averaged about 6 to 8 inches in our area. So thankfully, we didn't get the 12 to 18 inches that many people were forecasting for us, and also that was also what the National Weather Service was originally forecasting for us. So we actually managed to get by pretty well unscathed with these past few snowstorms. So it wasn't really too bad. I know something we want to get past, but we managed all right. As we go ahead to the 7 day forecast, I think for anybody who's looking forward to warmer weather and spring ahead, this is going to be very nice and just for you. Again, starting off on Friday, this is going to be our chilliest day of the 7 day period. Temperatures again around 30 and actually a pretty chilly morning going into Saturday. So a little bit cold if you have to get out there Saturday morning to do any errands. But look at this, by the time we get to Sunday, temperatures are going to be approaching the 50s. So we're really going to have the feel of an early spring coming in, that's for sure. As we see here, we're going to cool down maybe a few degrees on Monday, and we introduce a chance of maybe a little bit of, you know, spotty rain shower activity getting into Tuesday. But look at this. As we get into Wednesday and Thursday, we do introduce the chance of maybe a little bit of light rain getting into the tail end of Thursday. But look at this. Temperature's going to be climbing back up near 50 again. So it looks like we have some fairly nice weather ahead. So everyone, get out there and enjoy this great early spring weather that's going to be coming up for us here in the Burlington area. And have a great week.
Hi there, my name is Janet Fitzgerald. I'm on the board of directors of People Helping People, and I just wanted to remind everybody to come to our 6th annual wine tasting and charity auction at the Cafe Escadrille, hosted by Bob Murray. It's $50 a person, February 26th, 2 to 5 p.m. Tickets can be purchased at Spencer Cleaners, A Whole Bunch of Flowers, or by contacting me at 781-244-9519. Hope to see you there.
Hello, and welcome to your community calendar. Parents, does your family enjoy movies? On Tuesday, February 21st, from 11 to 12:45 p.m., the Burlington Public Library is having a family movie day. The movie they will be showing is The Secret Life of Pets. There will also be homemade popcorn. You can bring your own food, but no nuts. Everyone is welcomed, and the event is free. For more info, visit burlington.org or call 781-270-1690. Are you looking for something to do with your kids? On Tuesday, February 22nd, from 11 to noon, the Yo-Yo People will be performing at the Burlington Public Library. The Yo-Yo People are a husband and wife duo who do cool and amazing tricks with different varieties of yo-yos. They have been touring throughout the United States and in other countries. They have been on David Letterman, the Discovery Channel, and can be seen in the Guinness's Book of World Records. Everyone is welcomed, and the event is free. For more info, visit burlington.org or call 781-270-1690. One fish, two fish, red fish, blue fish. Can you guess which author wrote this? On Saturday, February 25th at 11 a.m., the Barnes & Noble in Burlington is celebrating Dr. Seuss's birthday. Dr. Seuss wrote many beloved books, including Green Eggs and Ham, One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish, and his most famous one, The Cat in the Hat. The books that will be read at the event will be The Cat in the Hat and What Pet Should I Get? There will also be coloring, activities, and more. The event is free. Everyone is welcomed. For more info, visit barnesandnoble.com or call 781-273-3871. This has been your community calendar. I'm Ian Cassiola. Back to you in the studio.
It was a busy week in high school sports here in Burlington. For all the latest on the Red Devils, we go now to BNews sports reporter Matt DiMarzio.
Hey everyone, this is Matt DiMarzio here with your weekly sports report. Plenty of exciting news in the world of Burlington sports these days, and it starts on the hardwood where BHS senior Mike DeMartinez made Red Devil history on Tuesday night. Martinez scored his 1,000th career point with a foul shot in Burlington's game against Wakefield. Not only did Martinez join an exclusive club at BHS, but he also helped the Devils beat Wakefield and take a major step toward qualifying for the state tournament. Under new coach Phil Connors, the Devils are now 8-10 with two games remaining, a Friday game on Thursday night in Wilmington and a contest next Tuesday night in Dracut. Burlington beat both Wilmington and Dracut earlier in the season and will qualify for the state playoffs with a 10-10 record if they win both of the remaining games. The girls' hockey team also had some exciting news this week. On Tuesday night, also against Wakefield, the Lady Devils skated to victory and wrapped up their second straight Middlesex League Freedom Division Championship. With a new goalie and several key players stepping into new roles, not many people expected Burlington to win another league title. So this title is especially satisfying to the girls. The boys hockey team also skated to a Freedom Division title, as expected, and is now preparing for two big upcoming events. First, the Devils will host their annual Cahoon Memorial Tournament at the Ice Palace. Tuesday, Burlington plays Medford at 7:15 p.m. The other semifinal game is Framingham and Chelmsford. The winners and losers will face off on Thursday at 6 p.m. and 8 p.m. Now on the wrestling mat, Josh Lee continued an amazing season and won the North Sectional Championship last weekend at 132 pounds. Lee and three teammates, Tommy DeRosa, Josh Becker, and John Larson, all earned spots in this weekend's Division II state tournament. The track and field teams have their Division IV state meets this week, as well with several Red Devils expected to compete for individual state titles. The boys have a shot at winning the team championship as well. Also, congrats to the boys' gymnastics team, who finished third at the recent state championship event. And that's all for your weekly sports report. I'm Matt DiMarzio, and back to you guys in the studio.
Another week, another photo to highlight. This week's photo shows just how much snow we received over the past week. It was sent in by Linda McNamee and features her two children, Gwyneth and Evan, standing on a tall snowbank. Thanks for the photo, Linda, and I think we can all agree that the stop on that sign should be applied to this wintry weather. We'd like to see your photos. They could be of something you see around town, the weather outside, your own door, or even photos of your family members and pets. I particularly like bird photos myself. Whatever you think is interesting and would like to share, we'd like to see. Email your photos to bcat@bcattv.org with the subject line, Photo of the Week. That's it from the news desk here at BNews Weekly. I'm Phil Gallagher, along with Rich Hosford, Tad Stefanak, Chris Flaherty, Robert Parris, Peter Brown with the weather, Matt DiMarzio with sports, and Ian Cassiola with the Community Bulletin Board. Thank you for joining us.